And after the day's work, the long night begins. Like the rest of us, Andrew wanders home through the darkening streets, looking at the silhouette of London's towers against the dusk. The Germans have destroyed Polish books wholesale where they could find them. But they have not destroyed the library of Poland and Britain. Still, they keep on trying. Each night, the bombers of the Luftwaffe take off from the dusky airfields of France towards the great lake of darkness that is London. Life goes on, though the bombs fall. This film that you see was in the cutting room during many a raid. Andrew improves his English, counting the bombs fall. Nothing can disturb the young Polish soldiers, sailors, and airmen. Singing the Krakowiak and the Mazurka, they enjoy a shelter party the Polish priest gives for them in the crypt of the Polish church. Through the night, though fires rage, and the hoses spurt defiance at the sky, the paper that Andrew will distribute the next day must be printed. To work, a boy must sleep, and does sleep. The wall embattled Germany does its best to prevent him. Don't worry, Andrew. You're getting used to it, as we all are. The raid must finish sooner or later. You cannot bomb the sun, and its light is not yet rationed. London's face has changed, and so has the face of the film studio where only last night we were working. But that hasn't prevented us from showing you this little story. A good omen for the Poles? Andrew takes his papers to his pitch. Perhaps he remembers the agony of Warsaw as he looks at battered buildings and shattered streets. There, however, death rained from the sky during daylight, while here it meets us at night. In September 1939, London looked upon Warsaw in its agony with pity. Today, Warsaw looks upon London with hope and prayer. Both towns are united by common faith. Silently they promise each other help in future reconstruction. New books are published in England. The most numerous readers of the Polish books is the army in Scotland. Many of the soldiers are veterans of the Polish campaign, of Norway, of France, and today they keep guard in Scotland. Thank you. Here is a boy who lost a leg at Narvik, receiving two official kisses from the Commander-in-Chief, followed by a third, which is quite spontaneous. Happy in Scotland, learning the reel, teaching the mazurka, and enjoying some of the finest hospitality in the world. Reorganized and re-equipped with the output of British factories, this is an army worth inspecting. The King and Queen thought so when they visited the Polish camps in Scotland, inspected troops, guns, and the positions they manned, and with their own particular charm, proved to our guests that British loyalty to the Crown is much more than a tradition. It's based on real affection. Like our own army at home, the Polish army must still wait for its great opportunity. But as Polish flyers joined in the Battle of Britain, so Polish sailors are helping to fight the Battle of the Atlantic, both with the Polish Navy and the mercantile marine. They are fine seamen, these men from the fogs and shallows of the Baltic shores. These Polish sailors love England. They are learning a lot from the first sea nation of the world. They know that after the war, they will bring many valuable experiences to their own harbors and ports. Those ports which held out so bravely against German attack from land, sea, and air. That's a very comforting sight.